Athens, the capital of Greece, and I'm standing on the Acropolis, which was created at the very dawn of European history. Now, in this series, I'm going to be studying all things Greek, both ancient and modern, by taking a journey through her incredibly rich history. This is where Western civilization began. Drama, democracy, language, science, medicine. This country has given us so much, and it's influenced the fabric of our everyday life. If you're like me, you probably know something or nothing about Greece. Some names are incredibly familiar. The Parthenon, Zeus, Mount Olympus, Socrates, Zorba the Greek. But beyond this patchwork knowledge is a country as different and surprising as any I've ever visited.
Oh, look at this!
From the living history of its islands to the turbulent borderlands and remote mountains in the land of the gods.
This is Delphi.
Roaming through this country to understand modern Greece, I follow a route through some of its most influential past, which shaped the world we live in today. Athens is one of the world's oldest cities, with at least 7,000 years of recorded history. Here, the past seeps out of every street corner. But one era defines this city more than any other, that of the ancient Greeks, who lived 2,500 years ago. I thought I'd start my odyssey in the south of the country, visiting the most important sites left by this great civilization. From places of theatre, myth, sport, and religion, they represent the very cornerstone of this empire. First on the list, the Acropolis, which surely defines the meaning of the word iconic. It was the beating heart of this civilization, a symbol of their democracy, wealth, and artistic philosophy.
Fantastic, so many people. So many tourists for this incredibly popular place.
Today, 1 million people visit the Acropolis each year, making it one of Greece's most popular tourist attractions.
Imagine being up here for the first time, like me, and seeing ahead of you the Parthenon, the great temple of the goddess Athena.
It's an architectural masterpiece made up of 15,000 pieces weighing 20,000 tons. This is the largest ancient building created entirely from marble.
It's always extraordinary to come to a building that you know so well from pictures and drawings and imitations around the world, just to come and stand in it and to be in this great temple. How did they do it? How did they get the weight of this stuff? How did they cut it so beautifully? And I mean, there are men here restoring, cladding it. Painstaking work. Oh, look, here's the person I'm longing to meet.
Hello, Joanna. How are you?
Dr. Ioannidou is in charge of the restoration project.
These marble cutters are working very hard in order to produce in the new marble the curving lines of these flutes.
So they look straight.
Yes, they look, but they are not straight. Curved. They are slightly curved.
To please the eye?
Yes, of course.
And you've kept the different colour for a purpose?
Yes.
Paler, but to show?
Yes, everybody can understand what is new and
what is old.
To rebuild the temple, the sculptors must complete the ultimate jigsaw puzzle. All the pieces of marble sitting loose around the monument must find a place. But to do that, they must produce new, intricate pieces that link together these ancient parts. Using many of the same tools and methods as their ancestors, each piece of new marble must match the exact contours of the original block.
They've got wet clay here, so that rather like the with the dentist, when he says to see if you've got a perfect bite, he puts a little piece of paper in and goes, and then you take it out to see where it's meeting or not. And it'll take about a month for each block like this to be done perfectly. So they can see by what's left here where this hasn't quite married, because they've got to make an absolutely perfect fit. If it's just like that, they have to take that bit off so that it fits absolutely like a glove. They only chip away from the new marble. The old marble is sacred. Staggering. This entire place is a work of absolute genius. Not the genius of one man, the genius of thousands of men. And do you know how long it took to build this entire temple? 10 years, that's all.
But this job will take longer than 10 years. It has suffered centuries of abuse.
Oh, look at this.
Yes.
First, it was used as a gunpowder store by the Ottomans, then blown up by the Venetians, and an Englishman, Lord Elgin, removed parts and sent them home to the British Museum. Even now a bone of contention between the Greeks and the British.
You do this every day.
Don't look down. Don't look down.
I won't look down, but you must go slowly and not leave me.
I'm being taken to see some of the restoration, but it's at a terrifying distance from the ground.
I have to hold on both sides because I have to lull myself into a sense of absolutely not looking down, being okay. Almost the greatest dread of my life is vertigo. As a child, I once got stuck on a ladder and my sister had to come and help me down. I was about 7. I got stuck and she had to move every finger and every foot to take me down, and it took about, I don't know, 25 minutes. So coming up here, I felt that, quite frankly, I was doing it for the viewers. That's you, because I love you.
The restorers working at these perilous heights are involved in their most delicate project, protecting the marble that has been ravaged by pollution and previous botched restoration work.
Is this water?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it's water. To remove the dust.
Yes.
From inside. You can see?
I can see. Look how it's coming off. And this is the figure of a man. He has his beautiful arm here. This is quite extraordinary because here we are on one of the most colossal, monumental buildings in the world. And look at the size of these tools that are being used, like a dentist's pick.
Yes, there are dentists. They are dentists.
They are dentists.
They are dentists.
And also this.
Oh, look at this.
Dentist.
Wow.
Is it?
Isn't that extraordinary?
The love and care that the modern Greeks are lavishing on this matchless monument are just what this glorious building deserves. From the White House in Washington to the Bank of England in the City of London, its architecture has been slavishly copied, a symbol of the importance of Greek culture throughout the world. After seeing the Acropolis today, it just made me think how little we know about ancient Greece, and how nice it would be if we taught Latin and Greek again in school so we could learn it. And it wouldn't just be the lucky ones who got to know about it. Now, there's something else that we don't know about Greece, is that we think that they smash plates. They don't, it's been outlawed. They threw so many plates at people to show their appreciation of singers and dancers that there were injuries. So they banned it, it's outlawed. Instead of plates, they throw flowers. Throughout Greek history, flowers have been used as offerings to the gods. I'm off to a bouzoukia, which is a modern twist on an old tradition. There are 50 of these clubs in Athens, which, after midnight, cater for Greeks who want a wild night out.
Joanna? Yassos?
Welcome to Caramella.
My host tonight is nightclub owner Yanis Boitipakos, which means naughty boy. This is no ordinary nightclub. Audiences can reach 5,000, dancing through the night to a succession of singers. But I've come for the main event, when crowds start to celebrate Greek style with flowers.
They have them on these little wicker trays, racked up five high. Those cost 60 euros, about 50 quid. And those were coming in and being thrown plenty. So this is extraordinary in a country which is, to a certain extent, really suffering very badly financially. I don't think a lot of them are tremendously rich.
In fact, Greece has one of the worst economies in Europe. But it's a tradition for bouzoukia revelers to pay a fortune for their flowers. Their bill for the night can be more than the cost of a brand new car.
We live for today, for this day.
For this moment.
Yes, for the moment. We don't care for tomorrow.
And you party all
tomorrow
the night.
Maybe everything. Boom.
Everything boom. And do you think when Greece recovers its economy, and becomes
I don't
strong,
think recover neither.
Don't you think?
No.
The most important thing is to go out, have a good time, make yourself happy. Let tomorrow take care of itself. Live for the moment. It's coming up for 3 o'clock now. That's pretty early for me, as you can guess, but I might just call it a day.
Whilst the culture of bouzoukia has changed to suit modern tastes, there's another tradition which has remained the same for thousands of years, which today is virtually unknown, even here in Greece. I'm saying goodbye to Athens and the mainland. My guide, Petros, is taking me to the isolated corner of Evia, the second largest island in Greece. Throughout ancient times, Evia bore the brunt of a succession of invaders intent on plundering Athens' riches. Here, the hills have echoed to the sounds of an astonishing language, thought to be a relic of those ancient invasions. Finally, we arrive at the village of Antia.
Up here?
I think so. Καλώς σας βρήκαμε. It's Kyria Koula.
Όπου θέλετε.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ. We can sit here.
Όπου θέλετε, είπα.
Μπορείτε να καταλάβετε τι λέει. Can't you understand?
I was only making it up. I don't know.
Τίποτα δεν λέει.
She says that she doesn't say something.
I didn't say.
Yeah, it's actually.
She's found me out. I was just whistling. So that's her sound. Here come some people. Sound is actually like people who can whistle for taxis, which I can't do because my whistling is. I've been trying to practice all my. Jennifer Saunders can do it. I can't make a sound. I just dribble. I'd be hopeless up here. I wouldn't be able to get any tea from a neighbour or anything. Do our ladies know where the tradition of whistling came from?
Εμείς έτσι το βρήκαμε, δεν ξέρω.
Από τους παππούδες.
1500 χρόνια λένε ότι είχαν πέσει οι Πέρσες εδώ.
Οι Πέρσες.
Γύρω στα 1500 χρόνια.
Εμείς το σφύριγμα το είχαμε και τ' άλλο. Το είχαμε σήμα. Άμα έρχεται ένας αστυνομικός.
Κλέφτης
εδώ. Που δεν ξέραν τη γλώσσα. Άμα θέλαμε να φωνάξουν τον άλλον, το φωνάζαμε με το σφύριγμα.
There is a belief that in ancient times, the invading Persians would post whistlers on the mountaintops as sentries, so they could signal an imminent attack on Athens. I'm just glad it wasn't my job.
Anywhere near it, it'd be as if I was dumb being up here.
Σφυράμε τα γίδια. Τα πρόβατα. Το σκυλί.
We run for the dogs. Look, the dogs. We've suddenly got a massive dog's
group. Ονόματα λέμε και τώρα, ό,τι όνομα θέλεις να σου πω. Πώς λένε τον ένα, πώς λένε τον άλλο, να σας πω όλους. Παλιά σπυρίζαμε πιο καλά, αλλά τώρα με τα δόντια δεν μπορούμε να σπυρίξουμε καλά.
That reminds me strangely of... There's a goat on the roof over there. They've called the goats who are now climbing over the roofs toward us.
Λέτε εδώ!
Look, more goats have arrived.
Amazing.
They know that we're going to be having tea in a second. They're travelling in. The cocks are crowing. It's extraordinary. It's the nearest thing to Dr. Doolittle I've ever seen. You just whistle and the goats answer back again. Then you shout at them and they've got it. Absolutely.
Let it go! Let it!
This extraordinary language is in danger of being lost to the world. 30 years ago, Antia was home to 100 people. Today, there are just 40. With all the youngsters gone, the school is closed. Only the older generation is left.
Kyria, is it important that whistling doesn't die out? How can you make sure that future generations will continue to whistle?
Είναι 40 άτομα στο χωριό. Και θέλουμε και εμείς προσπαθούμε να μάθουν και τα παιδιά να σφυράνε. Μας αρέσει, θέλουμε να μείνει αυτό, να μην χαθεί. Να σφυρίξουν, να μάθουν και τα παιδιά να σφυρίξουν. Να δούμε, θα τα καταφέρουν. Προσπαθούν.
It's sad to think that after hundreds of generations of whistling, Kyria Kula and her friends might be the last to communicate in this strange language. As yet, none of their children have learnt to whistle like their ancestors. I swapped my car for the train for the next leg of my journey. Somehow I didn't expect the weather to be so British.
Train's just left Athens here, and we're going to be travelling round into the Peloponnese, this sort of wild area which is so mysterious. And of course, the very birthplace of all the gods and myths and legends, and everything seemed to happen down here.
My route will take me to the region's most spectacular mythical and historic sites, discovering places that drew masses of pilgrims from across the ancient Greek world, ending my journey at this great civilization's most sacred place, Delphi. But first, my train is taking me to Epidavros, the most famous theater in the ancient world. As an actress, I'm longing to see this place. The legendary acoustics of what we call Epidaurus has attracted some of our modern-day greats like Pavarotti and Maria Callas. I'm meeting one of the most popular female singers of them all, Nana Mouskouri. Over her 50-year career, Nana is claimed to have sold more records in more countries than any other woman.
This
is nothing wonderful.
Epidavros was built in the 4th century BC to honor the god of healing, Asclepius, son of Apollo. It was a sanctuary to cure the sick, and for the Greeks, theater was part of the medicine. There were comedies, singing contests, and great tragic plays.
It's a very mystical place, and it's a place when everybody comes to participate, to get together.
One does feel an extraordinary presence here.
It is.
It's true, isn't it?
We believe that it is inhabited by gods, by semi-gods. Yes. The legends survive. And here, it's full of legends.
Have you sung here?
No, 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 I haven't had this honor, really, which was, it's the dream of every, I think, of every singer.
Trained as a classical singer, the young Nana was cast to sing in the chorus of an opera here. But at the last moment, she was dismissed, simply because she was considered to be a pop star.
When we arrived here, they got an order from the highest point possible to not to use me, because it became a scandal. And I was really, I came back the next day all by myself, crying all the way through. So it was something, for me, it was a sort of stigma.
Those slights, those injuries, but this sit deep in your heart. You know?
Yes, I think I never learned more than from my failures.
Yes, then this was no failure.
You can be heard all over the auditorium by an audience of 15,000. Especially if you stand bang in the middle of the stage.
The acoustics are so special. Can we test them? You don't think you'd sing?
Should I try?
Will you please try? Okay.
No, I'll try. I don't know what to do. I did not rehearse. I did not own my voice. But it's a pleasure. Yes, I will do it.
Miss Mosquri, this is your five-minute call.
Okay. I go fast, and I better have a good voice.
I should be able to hear Nana perfectly, right up at the back, 200 feet away. The shape of the theatre and the use of limestone rock reflect the sound perfectly.
So, Joanna, I'm on the right spot. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, Nana.
Okay. I can't hear you very well, but it's okay. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Maria, gratia plena, Maria, gratia.
Bravo, Nana! Thank you so much. Ευχαριστώ.
It's extraordinary without any rehearsal or any orchestra. I first saw Nana Mosquri when I was in my teens, I suppose. I mean, I didn't see. And it's just so odd as life goes by that you get to meet some of these great gods. Well, that was something to be in Epidavros and to hear Nana Mosquri singing for a tiny house on a Monday evening, but just sort of in the lap of the gods. Fabulous.
In the south of the Peloponnese is a remote region called the Mani. It's an area that was left behind by the modern world. A huge mountain range had kept the Mani Peninsula isolated and forgotten for thousands of years. At its southernmost tip, there's a place believed to be the mythical gates of Hades, where the ancients went when they died. Some say the people here are the direct descendants of the Spartans, the most bloodthirsty warriors of ancient Greece. My guide Petros and I have driven through Arcadia and Sparta on our way to the extreme south. He wants to show me this unique frontier land of Greece.
Only the last 40 years, the luxury of road came to Mani, was introduced in that place.
What did they do before?
They used to use donkeys.
Donkey tracks, just walking.
Donkey trails. So wild. Remote and rocky. This is Mandy.
Everywhere just seems to be rocks, rock hillsides, rocks on the ground. Everything looks like castles, of course, because of these tower houses. Everything. That little village just looks like a pile of tiny grey castles.
We're driving up to Vathia, a 16th century fortified tower house settlement. It's a town with a bloody past.
Hello, is there anyone there?
Yes, us.
Yes, us. There's nobody here. It's very strange.
In the mid-19th century, 300 people lived here. It was rife with blood feuds and vendettas.
Ooh, little door. Look at this, it's got a little platform with a bed here.
Local men hid in their tower homes after falling out with their neighbours, usually over land, or women. They'd take pot shots from here, trapped until they'd killed their enemy, who could be hiding just across the street. Often the victor would celebrate his success by nailing his neighbour's severed head to his front door.
There are beds in here. I feel rather creeped here. There's nothing here. There's just birds. I can see somebody.
Yes.
I can see somebody on a roof. Shall we go and say yas sas?
Yes, yes. Yas sas. Υπάρχει κάποιο καφενείο εδώ.
It seems that the few people left in Vathia still remain wary of strangers.
This way, this way.
Like other villages in the Mani, Vathia became a ghost town when the first roads were built in the 1970s. People in this area emigrated to Athens, leaving her land and houses empty. It has a desolate, breathtaking beauty.
Well, look, here's somebody. There's a dog and there's a little woman. Let's go and ask her. Yasas.
Yasas. Προχωράει ο δρόμος κι άλλο, συνεχίζει.
Όχι.
Τελειώνει.
Τελειώνει μέχρι πάνω στο σπίτι μου.
It's a dead end.
And so no cafe or anything, nowhere we can get a cup of coffee or stop or eat something.
Περάστε από το σπίτι μου να πιείτε καφέ.
But she just invited us. We can have a coffee at her house.
Oh, that would be wonderful.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Θα τη δεχτούμε την πρόταση.
Ναι. Τώρα είμαστε ωραία εδώ.
Tell me, what's it like in the winter here?
Εγώ μόνη είμαι εγώ το χειμώνα. Ανεβαίνει ένα παιδί και με κάνει παρέα, το παιδί μου δηλαδή.
It must be very cold and there's no... What does she live on?
Μαζούνε κανένα χορταράκι, κανένα σπαράκι, κανένα... Την περνάμε. Αυτά τα τρώμε, αυτά. Αλλά όχι τώρα, μικρά που είναι, μικρά. Τα καθαρίζουμε, ναι. Με λεμόνι, με φρικατσέ. Μυρίζει όμως λίγο, ε? Μυρίζει λίγο.
Very strong, beautiful.
Αλλά το γένουν, ε?
Aromatic.
Τώρα είναι μεστομένα, βέβαια, έχουν μεστώσει.
Fantastic.
Kyria Antonia lives a solitary life in this abandoned village and survives by living off the land.
This is a fabulous pathway, isn't it? It's a natural stairway. It's just extraordinary.
For supper, she's picking wild asparagus and has invited me to help her.
Can you imagine that this is the way you get your food, which is just by hunting these hillsides and finding not very much, just kind of leaves and little plants. She knows them all. It's just this lovely way of living wild, but gosh, what slim pickings. Looking for little strands of wild asparagus. A pick? Yeah.
Το κόψαμε.
That one, this one. Wild asparagus.
Well, Kyria Adonaya and I have been sort of hunting for a little bit. She obviously has got a much sharper eye because she can see exactly what she's looking for.
And I just hope that we get enough together so we can have a little supper, which he's promised to cook me. It's just the extraordinary kindness of people who seem to have so very much less than we do. Ah, Kyria, thank you. Look, two more to our collection. The wild asparagus is cooked in the simplest possible way. Boiled for 10 minutes in water. A little bit of salt. Some oil. And then it's almost ready to serve, except for one last vital ingredient. Lemons as sweet as oranges. Huge, beautiful lemons. Eat it almost perhaps a little bit like spaghetti, just tangling it up.
Savoury?
Mmm.
What are
you? Mmm. It's absolutely beautiful. Kyria, why do you still stay here when there's nobody here?
Αγαπάω το χωριό. 50 χρόνια είμαι. Μ' αρέσει πολύ. Χωριό.
Kyria, would you ever like to live in a city?
2 χρόνια. Πήγα πάνω, στην πόλη.
Did you like it?
Όχι. Εδώ μονάχα.
Kyria, do you get lonely here?
Όχι. Δεν φοβάμαι καθόλου τίποτα. Μην νοιάζει.
I should like to be like Kyria Antonia. I should like to be afraid of nothing. But I'm going to the gates of Hades, where the dead went to be judged. Even though I'm alive, will I be found wanting? Three mighty gods, Zeus, Poseidon, and Hades, drew lots to rule the world. Zeus got the heavens, Poseidon the sea, and Hades the underworld, whose entrance is in a cave. And it's only accessible by boat. It's quite strange to be sitting here in the peaceful sunlight with the waves lapping at my feet and knowing that just in a very short time, I shall be at the gates of hell, the gates of the underworld. And everyone can enter and no one can leave. And it's just strange because I've heard about these things all through my life and I thought I'd be feeling quite sort of lighthearted about it, but actually I feel very, very full of respect, a little bit, it feels quite serious. A local boatman, Petros Yorgariou, has been to the entrance before. In these parts, people still believe the gods and legends have meaning.
Πρέπει να δείξουμε τεράστιο σεβασμό. Σε βλέπω ότι το έχεις. Γιατί οι άνθρωποι που ερχόντουσαν εδώ, ερχόντουσαν στο Θεό. Ήταν πολύ ιερός τόπος, πολύ πριν από τους Δελφούς. Ήταν ό,τι πιο σπουδαίο που έχει να κάνει με τον άνθρωπο και με τον Θεό, το Τέναρο.
This is pre-Christianity, pre-Islam. This goes back to the beginning of time. So it's sort of pagan. So I think the idea of the underworld and hell being below and heaven being above is actually apparent in all religions, it seems to me. This old notion of that you would be damned for all eternity sort of rather gripped at the heart of me. So I'm taking every precaution today.
This is extraordinary. We're here at the very gates of Hades, of Hades here. Sort of unexpectedly modest little cave, but this is the very end of what was then the known world. After this, there's nothing but sea until you get to Africa. So this was the end of continental Europe here. This extraordinary place. So there are these flowers which I send as an offering. And also I have brought as an offering, it's really to Charon, the boatman who will be underground. I brought 2 coins. And I offer these to the gods. And one last thing I brought with me. I wanted to offer something that was of real value, and so I've brought a pearl, which is for the spirits of all the people who've gone into the underworld and can never come out again.
Ευχαριστώ, Δήμητρα, που μιλήσαμε στον Άδη, που μιλήσαμε μέσα μας.
As we retreat from the gates of hell, a strong wind whips up, blowing us safely back to shore. Tomorrow, we visit the birthplace of the most spectacular event on Earth, the Olympics. I've left the barren region of the Mani Peninsula behind. And I'm traveling north to perhaps one of the most famous of sporting arenas, ancient Olympia. With the Olympics in Britain almost upon us, I don't need to tell you how important sport is in our society. It all started in Olympia nearly 3,000 years ago. The ancient Olympic Games were the pinnacle of athletic achievement. With half a square mile of ruins, the site was a health sanctuary, a bit like a modern-day Olympic village. At its very heart is the place where men were worshipped like gods.
This is the archway through which all the Olympic athletes passed. Thick walls, you can almost feel it sort of throbbing off it. Bunched up, nerves jangling, sweating slightly with the anticipation of this phenomenal trial ahead of them. Look, 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 this is the stadium. Look at the size of this place. This held 45,000 spectators, and they all sat on grass, except for the judges who sat on seats. They had running races. They always had the same sort of disciplines. There was the pentathlon, which was running, jumping, or jumping from a start like that. It was throwing the javelin, it was throwing the discus, and it was wrestling. What they didn't have in those days was synchronized swimming, ping pong. Know what I mean? Man's games, held in the nude. Married women weren't allowed to come and watch them because it was considered that the athletes were so attractive. And here come some damn attractive athletes just sprinting past now. The athletes were so attractive that the women wouldn't be able to contain themselves and would become unfaithful to their husbands. So virgins or unmarried girls were allowed in to watch. Women weren't allowed to do anything.
Vous connaissez les histoires des Olympiques, les Jeux Olympiques?
Un peu, parce qu'on y a...
A little bit? I asked a little bit if they know about the Olympic Games and the history, and I think they've come here probably just to learn about it. The great thing is that the second you arrive here, all you can think about is just testing yourself off. You can't help it, it's like a kind of trigger. You go, the Olympic track, I must run it. And even though it's extremely hot, il fait très très chaud aujourd'hui, still, you just have to do it, just to match yourself up to those Olympian standards. Of course, these being girlies wouldn't have been allowed here in the old days, so times have changed. Merci beaucoup.
Delphi lies to the north of the Bay of Corinth. It was the most sacred place in the ancient world, where emperors, peasants and warriors alike sought the mystical predictions of the oracle. I'm following in the footsteps of Odysseus, Alexander the Great, and Apollo himself. This is Delphi. Lives.
And there's a huge resonance about this valley. It's fantastic. Why do they come here to this particular place, even before it's called Delphi? Well, this is why. Zeus released two eagles at the end of the earth, and where they met and clashed was here. And so this became what Zeus called the navel, the tummy button, the navel of the world, the very center, the very core. So this was already chosen by Zeus, god of gods, to be the center of the world. We are standing now in the center of the world. No wonder people came here, for whatever reason. And they still do in their thousands. But some people come for more than souvenirs and photographs. 54-year-old James Head was living in London working as a maths teacher until he came to Delphi for the first time 12 years ago.
So what happened? You arrived here?
All of a sudden, it was a kind of eureka moment for me that perhaps there is something sacred, something holy somewhere, yeah, and in different places. And it just so happened that the first time I ever had that feeling was here in Delphi.
For you, this sense of spirituality came alive because of Apollo.
It came alive in this place, and I suppose this place is firmly associated with Apollo. It was a life-changing experience for me.
How has it changed your life?
From that first visit, I find myself living here full-time. Obviously, I visit the temple regularly. I say a few prayers. As in ancient times, I offer a little wine to the god.
A little libation, whatever
it is. I don't really understand why it is I do it. I just feel that that is something I like to do. And although I have traveled a little and could travel to other places, I find myself coming back here time and time again. Because when I'm up there pouring my libation, Joanna, there's nowhere I'd sooner be.
Now it was my turn to meet Apollo, the god of light, prophecy, and truth. It seems extraordinary that 100 years ago, this sacred site, in the shadow of Mount Parnassus, was hidden from the world, covered by 30 feet of earth, with a village built on top. When the French excavated it, they were astonished and delighted to find a ruined city of 3,000 statues, monuments, and temples.
These steps would have been alive with pilgrims plodding up their last weary way at the end of this immense journey to come to the center of the world, the place they'd been longing to see. The Temple of Apollo.
This is how the Temple of Apollo would have looked in ancient times. The most important decisions in ancient Greek history were made by the oracle who sat underground in the center of the temple. But scientists today have discovered that the site was built on the top of an ancient fault line which emitted hallucinogenic gases.
And look here. Now, I've been told about this. This is where the Delphic oracle had her tripod seat. The legs of the tripod were there. So her seat, this was obviously that way around. The seat was here. And here in front is the hole through which the methane or ethanol gas or came hurtling out anyway, some sort of mind-altering gas. And she was sitting on here. Some people say she was chewing daphne leaves, whatever it was. She was in a complete trance, in a complete stewed state. And so what people asked her, she was actually talking in tongues. And funny enough, I've seen this up in the high hills of Hunza in the Karakorums, where they inhale juniper smoke. So people became high as kites. And this prophetess, this seer, this oracle, was high as a kite and couldn't even speak her own language. She was just gibbering. And priests listened and interpreted. And people came and said, should we go to war? Is this a wise thing to do? Should I get married? Should our country separate? Should we fight with this city? And the oracle would, la, 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 and the priests would interpret it. So the priests were terribly important, terribly influential. But the oracle was the thing. She was always a woman over 50. And she was called Pythia, named after the python,
which is what Apollo slew. I know this sounds complicated, but it's absolutely fascinating when you can get your head around it, which I almost have. I'll just take a whiff of this, then I could probably speak to you in tongues. I could still say Mount Parnassus. This is my hero. If the oracle had spoken to me, she would have said, I see you traveling in Greece, and in the next episode you shall explore the remote northern borderlands. So, who am I to defy the ancient oracle of Delphi?
Next over on ITV2, Keith finds himself in a bit of a lather. It's a soap star celebrity juice special. While on ITV3, we're handing out the daggers in the Specsavers Crime Thriller Awards 2011. Here, it's the news at 10.